a foundational set of beliefs that we grew up with, learned, absorbed, became part of our identities about the nature of man. What are we as humanity? What is the nature of man? And as Colleen was very rightly and strongly pointing out earlier, this is foundational to the worldview of Adventism. And I'm going to talk about that. How is it so important as a worldview? In what ways do you see this? Well, first we'll talk about what a worldview is. She was a woman that people didn't expect much of. She was not famous except for probably for the wrong things. But God had an encounter with her that changed history. And I'm not talking about Ellen White. She came to the well in the middle of the day so she didn't have to deal with her peers who would gossip about her and persecute her. She was that woman. Well, Jesus met her in a way that not only changed history, but revealed himself powerfully and clearly in even ways that he had not discussed with the Jewish leaders. We're going to talk about what Jesus said to her. And first, we're going to talk about what is a world view. Jesus told her she wanted to have a debate about right worship. You worship on, in Jerusalem, we worship on this mountain, Mount Gerizim. And Jesus said, God is spirit. We're neither going to worship on this mountain or in Jerusalem. The time is coming and now is. Because God is spirit, and those who worship him worship in spirit and truth. This was so profound. Here he is talking to this uneducated peasant woman of ill repute who was not even of his nation and giving some of the most profound theology ever spoken to anyone, anywhere. That was important too. And because she was a woman too. A worldview is something that reveals your deepest set beliefs, the way you think, the way you approach the world, what is important to you. As defined by James Sire, he's a Christian philosopher, in his book, The Universe Next Door, he said, a worldview is a collection of attitudes, values, stories, and expectations about the world around us, which inform our every thought and action. Worldview is expressed in ethics, religion, philosophy, scientific beliefs, and so on. So worldview is really important. You may have, everyone has a worldview, but you may not be aware of what its details are unless someone can discuss it with you. We as Adventists grew up with a worldview that was given to us, whether we were conservative Adventists, liberal Adventists, Badventists, what have you. There's worldview there. Foundational to the Adventist worldview, or as the Germans call it, we talked about capitalized German words. Kaspar said Weltanschauung, worldview. There is a name for this foundational Adventist worldview, and we're going to talk about some of these founders, some of the men in the early 19th century who were extremely influential in presenting this worldview we're going to call physical monism. Physical monism. In the early 19th century, there's a gentleman named George Storrs, and he was very convicted that the eternal burning hell of conscious lost people was a terrible heresy, and he was part of that movement called conditionalism. And their conditionalism became quite radical. It wasn't just saying we don't believe in an eternally burning hell. This went far beyond that into saying the human person is only a physical person. There is nothing that survives you after death. When you die, you are annihilated, and then there's a resurrection. So it was very physicalist. Some of them became even more radical, such as Joseph Bates, who said that God actually has a body, and that body is physical. It's just that you can't see it, and you can't look at it. The angels have bodies. You just can't see them. After all, they appear to men, and they have arms and legs, and they speak, and you can talk to them. So they're really physical beings. They're just, but you can call them spirits, but they're physical. Charles Taze Russell was also part of this movement. He was influenced by George Storrs. George Storrs was influential with Joseph Bates and with other of the Adventist founders. Charles Taze Russell, of course, was the founder of the Watchtower Society and Jehovah's Witnesses. One of their number was famous for making his very bold statement. He said, "The proper name of our system is called materialism." Hey, say it like it is, brother. And it is a very materialistic philosophy, that really all there is in the universe that is in existence is material. It really puts all of creation and on all the spiritual realm in the same level. So this idea of physical monism we see there at the beginning of Adventist origins, there in the story of Genesis. According to the Seventh-day Adventist version, as we read in Ellen White, Patriarchs and Prophets, and many of her other statements, here are the things that were important to them. Now, this is a summary that I took largely from the Sabbath School Net, Sabbath School Lesson, also from Patriarchs and Prophets and others. The number one thing that was put there as an important aspect of being made in God's image. What does that mean, made in God's image? Well, here's really where this worldview comes out. Free will and individuality. You must have this absolute free will, this ability to choose or not choose or to reject God. And that is at the seat of your individuality as a person, as a unique human being. But then the second point that was so often made, and really in some ways is the most important to them, that we have bodies in the likeness of God's body. And as it says there in Genesis, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. And they took those two words and said, image and likeness are not the same thing. Image refers to the mental, and likeness has to do more with the physical. They even went to, you're not going to find this among Hebrew scholars, I don't think. Somebody correct me if I'm wrong, and this was in the Sabbath School Net lesson. Image, tselem, means, I had it backwards. Physical resemblance and likeness, demut, is mental likeness. They had this all nice and neatly separated out. So that's how they can get us and Adam having God's body, God's physical resemblance. That's important to them, that human beings physically resemble God. Now, out of this idea of us being purely physical monism, as we say, comes this Adventist doctrine of SDA holism. Holism, to the Adventist, doesn't mean taking into account everything. It's something more subtle than that. It means that soul and mind and body are a whole, an inseparable whole. You can't separate them from each other in any way, so that when the human person with a body, who is a body, when that person dies, there's nothing left. They just become dirt. Now, they will quote you those texts in Ecclesiastes and other places that the breath goes back to God. But really, what does that mean, for breath to go back to God? Does my breath, my physical breath, literally go floating off into space and find God somewhere, or he takes it? You know, it's really a meaningless phrase, the way they try to explain it. Physicalism, when you really start to look at it in detail, it has many serious contradictions, and we'll see some of the problems with this. So Ellen White waxed eloquent in explaining how God has a body. And this is from Erling Writings, page 54. She says, "I saw a throne, and on it sat the Father and the Son. I gazed on Jesus' countenance and admired his lovely person. The Father's person I could not behold, for a cloud of glorious light covered him. I asked Jesus if his Father had a form like himself. He said that he had, but I could not behold it, for said he, 'If you should once behold the glory of his person, you would cease to exist.'" So that's how she describes the Father, seeing him on his throne, but could not discern his physical, human-like form. This is foundational to Adventism. This isn't just some aberrant or throwaway idea of Adventism. It is central, as we shall see. So at the creation, man was to bear God's image. Okay? Here is a quote from Ellen White, Patriarchs and Prophets, page 45. "Man was to bear God's image, both in outward resemblance and in character." Now notice this. This is subtle. "Christ alone is the express image," whatever that means to her, "expressed image," and she quotes Hebrews 1:3, "of the Father, but man was formed in the likeness of God." How does she separate that out? Being likeness of God is different than being the express image. Okay. Now, when we understand this from a biblical Christian worldview, we know the express image means he is God himself. He is equal. He is divine. He is the second person of the Trinity. But there is a subtle demotion of Christ here, and I'm going to show you this. It's very important also that this likeness include the physical. Uriah Smith wrote books about this, about the non-immortality of the soul, of there being, you know, and to him that meant that we are only physical. He says, God has to have a body. He is physical himself. That's all there is. Where does the Bible say that God is a formless, impersonal being, having neither body nor parts? Well, I guess it doesn't. Does it need to? It says he's spirit. Jim?
Where the Bible does it say the Father has a man-type body?
Oh, yes. Uriah would take you on with that. He would say, he has a lot of fantastic convoluted logic that goes on for hundreds of pages about how, you know, well, here it talks about God's hand. Here it talks about God's nostrils and the stench of their sacrifices. Here it talks about, you know, you can't argue with this with someone who is as completely dedicated to this idea of the physical. A physical monist is so dedicated to this idea, as I will show you. Anyway, with the Adventist development of their theology from the very early 1850s and 60s, the physical monism was taking place with the health message and with many other things. There have been many unfortunate consequences of physical monism within Adventism and with any group that does not understand human beings as having a truly spiritual side, that the humans have a spirit that puts them and gives them value before God. Made in the image of God is much more than physical. Now, some of the unfortunate results of this, I will show you. Children and babies. children and babies, if they do not have anything but a body, and their value of their body is based on certain characteristics such as intelligence and free will and things that you can measure physically, they're not going to be seen as quite as valuable if they don't measure up to those characteristics, if they're not quite as valuable with, you know, they're not getting the good grades, or what if they're born with certain characteristics. That is why in Adventist hospitals they have abortions that are offered right over here. Just a couple of miles away, abortions are performed. And in fact, one was offered to my wife for our son because some little DNA test came up. What was it? I forget what the test was called, was honey. But the nurse there said, this looks like a little bit of anomaly. There could be something wrong. There is a slight chance they might have Down syndrome. If you would like to take the option of abortion, we certainly can offer it here. And Sharon says, no, not do that to my baby. But that is part of the logic of this. If all you are is physical and your physical traits are what make who you are. Now here is the Adventist teaching. I'm getting this from the 28 Fundamental Beliefs. And I was brought to attention by this by Colleen and Nikki from their excellent podcast. They're going through the 28 Fundamentals, and they have that podcast on the nature of man. Listen to it, you get a chance. It's very good. And they mentioned this here from their discussion of what a living soul is. Babies become living souls only at birth. They must breathe, because after all, a body plus breath equals a living soul. That's the formula they get there from Genesis 1. God breathed, or Genesis 2, God breathed into Adam the breath of life, and Adam became a living soul. So soul is only breath. It's nothing immaterial. It's not spiritual. They only become a unique unit of life, and that's the wording, at birth and when they take their first breath. Now, before birth, even at 9 months, it's not a unique person. Personhood comes with breath. Now, think about what the implications of that could be when you're dealing with children. What if the parent suddenly decides, the mother, she doesn't want to have this child at 9 months, and it hasn't taken its first breath? What she could do. Babies become persons only at birth. When they take their first breath, they become separate from other, I like that term, life units. Colleen, wasn't that the term used? Individual or unique life units. So you're all unique life units because you breathe. Think about that. I like this picture of this little girl. She was born premature, difficulties with the pregnancy, and she's holding there a picture of herself right after birth. Most children would have died, but Lexiani was born at 25 weeks gestation, and she's done quite well, as we can see. It's so much more than, the image of God is so much more than what is merely physical. And it also raises important and disturbing questions about how do you see the image of God in kids born with various types of genetic anomalies, Down syndrome, other disabilities, things that we would call malformations. Are they less in the image of God? These two kids here, they're loved and celebrated by their parents, but many parents feel and will abort their kids because they feel because they will have a lower IQ score, they may not succeed in school, they're going to require more care, so on. There's some important implications here if you do not see the image of God in every child. Back to the garden, back to Eden. The fall of man, according to the Adventist physical worldview, Ellen White boiled it down to the temptation being appetite. Adam fell by the indulgence of appetite. Christ overcame by denial of appetite. Remember, she said there in Desire of Ages that when the devil came to her, he said the very first temptation was make the stones into bread, because that was the first sin of Adam, was failure to control his appetite. And our only hope, now here's a worldview statement if there ever was one, our only hope of regaining Eden is through firm self-control. Oh, God help us. Well, the physical worldview is really very well spelled out for all to see in the Ellen White compilations. I took these statements from Councils on Diets and Foods. You can read many of these other things like Healthful Living. And I wanted you to get the gist of it here. Put on your worldview examination, thinking cap. Think of this in terms of how you view the world. You grew up, I'm assuming a lot of you, maybe all of you, grew up with, most of you didn't, these statements read to you. They were read to me. Here's a worldview statement. Disease never comes without a cause. Oh, stop there. Cause. What sort of cause? Disease never comes without a cause. What does that imply about anybody who gets cancer or tuberculosis or born blind? The way is prepared and disease invited by disregard of the laws of health. Live with that. That's a worldview. Or, I have been instructed that flesh food has a tendency to animalize the nature. Animalize the nature. To rob men and women of that love and sympathy which they should feel for everyone. So eating meat will make you less loving and less sympathetic. Okay. And to give the lower passions, there's the higher parts of the brain, the nervous system, and then there are the lower animal passions that, you know, to be like the things that you eat. You know, if you eat pig or bull, then you're going to, you know, okay, poor James. And to give the lower passions control over the higher powers of the being. Animalistic. Animalize. That's a worldview. Very subtle, very powerful. And then, of course, the thousands of rules about when and how you can eat. We find it best for all concerned to have only 2 meals per day. Did anybody grow up with that? My family went through that for a while. I was either hungry and complaining and cranky, or very full and dopey and, you know, got made up for being made fun of for being a dopey kid. Of course, you know. We grew up with this. This is a worldview shaping kind of presentation of the body. Self-control, don't get animalized by meat, avoid flesh foods, avoid rich desserts, 2 meals per day. You eat too much, eat less, okay? Now, more important to Adventist theology than probably any other item that Adventists have preached, that the health message has been very important. We'll call this the health message that we just looked at there with that picture of Elmshaven behind, so you can enjoy that. But the law of God, Ellen White's understanding of the law and God was very physical. And let's talk about how physical that really was. As a system of theology, this is something that I appreciate what you ladies said in your podcast about the physicalism of Adventist theology affecting all parts of it. It isn't just limited to the diet. Let's look at this. you had God's law standing over you. You could just imagine these giant stones there just glowering down on you and condemning you or commanding you. But you could do just what Jesus did, because he had no advantage over us, and we could be just as obedient, and we could live eventually the perfect life by God's grace, of course. So we were under the law. We placed ourselves under the law in a very powerful way that even most Christians who tend to be legalistic, even they didn't experience, because through Ellen White, we had thousands and thousands of other regulations that were all built around it. That Ellen would say, these are the laws of nature, and the laws of nature and the laws of God are equal and they work together, and you can't violate them. Part of this physicalist system was our idea of the fourth commandment and the seventh day Sabbath. And you had this physical system of living under the seventh day Sabbath, because after all, the Sabbath time interval was determined by the motion of the earth, this physical body that turned once every 24 hours. And after it rotated seven times, then you were promised a special blessing of God's extra presence for you. And of course, you see there in the Old Testament that their system that God ordained had very physical, strong elements to it. There was a seventh-day Sabbath, but there was also the cycles of the moon. Notice there at the end of Isaiah, from Sabbath to Sabbath and new moon. Remember, it talks about the new moons there, other places. It was also a lunar system. The system of feasts depended upon the lunar cycle. And as Adventists, we left the moon out, but we kept the cycles of the earth. And as we picked and chose what parts of the law we wanted and we thought that we were obligated to keep. But the Ten Commandments, as we interpreted it, was more than just the Ten. It included other selected portions, such as not working on the Sabbath, not buying and selling on the Sabbath, and things like that. It was especially around the Sabbath that we picked laws from Leviticus and Deuteronomy and so on. But it was a very physicalist system, because it was about very measurable types of behavior. It's where you have yourself on Sunday morning. You better not be at church. Where is your body on Sabbath morning? Or it better be at church. It's where you have your posterior sitting on a certain day. It's very measurable. It's very apparent. It's what you can see people doing. It's less a matter of the heart. And yes, a good Seventh-day Adventist will sincerely say, yes, we should love each other. We should have loving, bonded families, and all those things are important. But really, when it comes down to it, the law is about what you do, about your behavior. Now, we had the sanctuary doctrine. The sanctuary was also a very physicalist system. And we looked at that, and remember that statement that was so often quoted to us when we studied the sanctuary, as in the type, so it must be in the antitype. Remember that? So it had to be the same. So if you saw something in the tabernacle there in the wilderness, then the antitype was, of course they would say, it's either what Christ came to do on earth, or it was the sanctuary in heaven. So that the identical sanctuaries had to exist, because after all, the sanctuary in the desert was a copy. So you had, as they explain it, there was blood being taken into the tabernacle and being sprinkled, and the blood, according to Adventist theology, carries the sin. So this blood somehow was transferred through Christ when he died. This is in this is in the antitype. So blood was somehow transferred to the heavenly sanctuary and defiled the sanctuary there until it could be cleansed at the investigative judgment. A very physical, unspiritual system that denies the very forgiveness of sins of the gospel. And of course they had a Jesus a Levitical priest Jesus doing his very physical thing there in a literal sanctuary in front of a literal Ark of the Covenant that had a literal physical tablet of stone underneath it with the Ten Commandments, and presenting his sacrifice to the Father. What became even more disturbing to me was as I was studying these statements by Ellen White about Jesus and his incarnation and who Jesus was and what kind of nature Jesus had. Listen to the statement and listen to how she compares Jesus, the nature that he took, versus the nature of what kind of person Adam was. The Son of God humbled himself and took man's nature after the race had wandered for 4,000 years from Eden and from their original state of purity and uprightness. Sin had been making its terrible marks upon the race for ages, and physical, mental, and moral degeneracy prevailed throughout the human family. So this is what Jesus inherited, according to Ellen White. Physical, mental, and moral degeneracy. When Adam was assailed by the tempter in Eden, he was without the taint of sin. He stood in the strength of his perfection before God. How do you like that comparison of Jesus and Adam? And it doesn't end there. This elevation of Adam as what we really all want to go back to and restore creation. Back to Eden is a very powerful theme, as you see it here. Adam, and she goes on to talk about how he was all his organs and his systems were all in perfect harmony and balance and all this kind of thing. But Jesus had inherited 4,000 years of degeneracy in his nature. Wow. And in contrast to that, we have God's word, Hebrews 7:26, for it was indeed fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, innocent, unstained, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. I don't hear any degeneracy in there. We have to so cling to the word of God and really know how Jesus is portrayed and exalted and proclaimed in God's word. As Adventists, we could get so lost in all these arguments about, oh, you know, just how human was he really? And, did, you know, oh, if it wasn't fair to us if Jesus had some sort of advantage in his holy nature. We stay with the Word of God. Oh, my friend here, we're talking about the Grand Canyon. Yeah. If our gospel is veiled, if we, as Adventists or Ellen White, were unable to see the gospel, if it's veiled to them, in their case, in my case, before I knew, the God of this age has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel and of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Now, this is incredibly important. Who is the image of God? Do we look back to Adam as our example of the perfect image of God? No. You look in the New Testament, there's this grand theme all the way through it, from the Gospels all the way through to the end, that the Lord Jesus himself is the very image of God, and he always was. Yes, Adam was created perfect, but Jesus was the one lamb slain from the foundation. Jesus was the one who we should look to as the very image of God. The light of the gospel, the glory of Christ. That's what's hidden from those who can't believe. So when Jesus sat down with the teacher of Israel, Nicodemus, who came to him by night, Nicodemus had a certain belief. He had a certain belief that Jesus came from God. We know, as speaking for he among the Sanhedrin, we know that you came from God because no one can do these things that you do unless God is with him. But then Jesus says, unless you're born again, you won't see the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, explaining why new birth is necessary. No, you don't enter into your mother's womb a second time. Nicodemus was a physicalist too. He saw things in physical terms. And now this, he was not stupid. Nicodemus was one of the best educated of the nation. He was the teacher of Israel, as the Greek says. But when Jesus presented something spiritual, Nicodemus was not spiritually alive yet. He could not understand spiritual things yet. But here, Jesus sat down with him and took time with him and opened his mind to the scripture like he had never seen it before, especially Ezekiel 36, about being born of water and the spirit. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. Oh, that's something you can't see. You can't measure it. You can't put it into a ritual. You can't command it as a law. You can't even choose it for yourself when you want to. The Spirit is God. He's sovereign. He does this when he wants to, and you won't see it coming necessarily. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Spiritual life is not physical. It's not a change in your DNA. It's not God messing with the lobes of your brain. It's not God changing, you know, something in here physical, so he, you know, like flipping a switch or tweaking some organ. It's supernatural. You can't see it. You can't measure it. And he does it when he wills, because he's God. The Spirit gives life to our spirits. Before that happens, we are dead, spiritually dead. A spiritually dead person means not that you can't think or feel or choose anything, but it means that you are dead to the things of God. You don't know him, you can't hear him, you can't perceive him. And even worse, you don't desire him, and you're a rebel against him. You're his enemy. That's spiritually dead. But he can come, and just as he said at creation, let there be light, and show you the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. That's the moment we become alive. The gospel comes with a spirit to give life. And before the new birth, there is nothing there that responds to God and wants him unless he, the Spirit, gives you that gift. And sometimes it takes a long time for him to draw us. It took me a long time. I was an agnostic for quite a while after I left Adventism. But I can remember specific times of feeling that drawing. Becoming like Christ is even more powerful and more wonderful when we realize it is not becoming a super person or a more intelligent person or something that materialistic, physical Adventism taught us. It's being renewed in the spirit of your mind. It's changing from our deceitful desires, our former manner of life, being renewed in the spirit of your minds. And being put on the new self. Is it going back to Eden, becoming more like Adam, growing to be 12 feet tall, or even just, you know, being better at debating in Sabbath school, you know, in the morning? No, it's created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. It's having the qualities of Christ, loving your brother and sister, especially people that are hard to love. Those qualities of mercy and caring and unselfishness that don't come naturally to us. That's supernatural. Loving a relative who hates you. True righteousness and holiness. Like Romans 29 says, we have been predestined. How does it say it? Suddenly mind drew a blank, my COVID fog here. Anyway, to become and be transformed into the image of Christ so that he might be among many brothers. That's what becoming Christ like Christ is. It's not being a better Sabbath keeper. It's about that quality of keeping the great commandments, loving God and loving man. So let's go back and look at that woman at the well again. Enter into that conversation. Jesus said, the hour is coming, when she had just compared their religions. And he said, salvation is of the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. Wow. What does that mean? Did she understand that when he said it to her? Probably not. But she remembered it. And she was moved by it. Jesus did not waste words on her. His words do not return to him empty. He went especially to that Jacob's well to meet with her and to deliver this amazing, powerful theological truth and to reveal himself as the Christ. He openly told her that he was the Messiah. He's looking for such people to worship him. God is spirit. What does that mean? God is spirit. Does it mean it's just you can't see him, but he really has arms and legs and a nose and mouth? No, it means he's not part of his own creation. He's transcendent. As Gary Enrig was telling us this morning, if you don't understand how God is completely transcendent from his creation and separate, that he is completely spirit, then God is a part of creation and you're worshiping something and someone else. You might as well be pagan, whatever else you want to describe about God, if he's part of his creation. But Adventism being so physical, God is part of his creation. He even lives in creation. They've got his address over there in the Orion Nebula. You know, yeah, I can. In the winter sky, you can see it up there with a pair of binoculars. Oh, God's up there, you know. Yeah, that's where Jesus is coming. Tremendous Adventist legend. Very physicalist. God being confined within his own creation. How can he be creator if he's confined within it? He's not part of his creation. And he's not physical. And he is not limited by time or space. That's how he knows the future. And that's a strictly divine prerogative that only God can know the future and the past exhaustively, as he says in Isaiah 46. So our worship of this God who is so awesome and infinite and above all creation can't be limited to time and space. He's not limited to time and space. If I sit my butt down in this chair instead of that one, or worship on this day instead of that one, or go to this temple versus that temple, it's putting God in the confines of one of those pagan gods who wants to meet you in just a certain place because that's his domain. He's ruler of heaven and earth, and he's a spirit. So we worship him in spirit and in truth. Anywhere, anytime, you can approach him. Like it says in Hebrews 4, we can boldly approach the throne of grace. That's worshiping in spirit. So the whole thrust of the Bible, and especially of the New Testament under the New Covenant, we have the glory of Christ presented as not just plan B with Adam being plan A because he was the pinnacle of creation. No, he wasn't the pinnacle of creation. I love what the writer of Hebrews says here in the second chapter. He says, you crowned him with glory and honor and subjected everything under his feet. He's quoting Psalm 8. Speaking about man, what is man that you're mindful of him? Crowned with glory and honor, subjected everything under his feet. For in subjecting everything to him, he left nothing that is not subject to him. Was that fulfilled in Adam? Come on, that's not a hard question. Okay, I'll help you. As it is, we do not yet see everything subjected to him. But we do see Jesus. And everything has been subjected to Jesus, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Remember he said that right at the Gospel Commission? So it doesn't, we don't see everything as subjection to him, but it is in reality. We see Jesus made lower than the angels for a short time so that by God's grace he might taste death for everyone. So this is our hope and our solution for the Adventist physical monism that worships the physical, that worships things of creation. We see Jesus, and we worship truly in spirit and in truth, and there's nothing more liberating than that.